Hello, Zach. How was your Thanksgiving?
Oh, man. The pork I made 4 pounds of pork.
Four pounds. Jeez.
It was too greasy.
Well,
otherwise, pretty great.
You know what's crazy, Zach? It's November, but look over there. There's a ghost. Look.
Hello.
Hello. Hello, everybody. This is Ghost Train of Thought. He is on TikTok, a very viral TikToker, and he also has a YouTube channel that you should subscribe to. How are you, sir?
I'm doing very well. Thank you for inviting me. I'm actually really excited to be here. I've been doing a lot of guest spots on various channels, just trying to get myself out there, and I appreciated you actually reaching out to me. That was quite thoughtful of you.
Well, I'm just glad you answered the call. I love your content, watch it all the time. Great guy. Should watch him on TikTok and give that YouTube channel some support because he deserves it. Good man.
Appreciate it. I love watching your guys' stuff too. I watch a lot of Pauly Pete stuff on TikTok. That's where I know him mostly from. That's where we got to know each other. Got a lot of good ideas from you. So.
Oh, thank you. I'm blushing.
That whole like Zoan weaponry thing was huge.
Oh yeah, I remember that. Yes. It seems like such a obvious thing in hindsight, but I don't know. I just never really put any serious thought into it until I made that video. I'm like, oh no, yeah, this would how it would work. You can't really have an item eat a paramecia because that would null and void the whole life-death cycle that Devil Fruits operate on. So, yeah, but thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, I loved it because it's like you're putting a concept into an item. There's no life. The only thing that has life is the Zoan, technically. Like, they all have the devil inside, but the only thing that has that innate will and life after the fact is a Zoan.
Hmm. True.
It's strange.
Cause
it's weird that Vegapunk wouldn't think of that. Like, he's been trying to like do it so long.
Yeah.
Well, Vegapunk tends to not think of a lot of things.
Like how?
Well, yeah. Go ahead.
No, you're the guest. Go. You go.
I was gonna say like we were talking about earlier, how he was impressed by Frankie with his whole cola experiment and fuel source. He's just like, how are you projecting yourself like a kilometer with just cola? That's insane. Like, he's impressing Vegapunk. So you're right. He doesn't think of like the simple things.
YOF, boys. We still have a full month to go. The year of Frankie never ends.
Never ends.
Oh, Frankie's the best.
He is. I
love him.
I love when our guests love Frankie. It's very super.
Or, you know, other things that Vegapunk hasn't forgot, or just kind of slipped his mind, kind of forgot about, like, you know, cloning a man who is said to be genetically determined to be evil. Oh, dear.
How did he
Are
get
we talking about Doofus Domingo here?
Yeah. Exactly. Yes. Oh, and you gave him, you made him a pyrokinetic angel. Oh,
Domingo.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, you gave him even more durability and spite.
Well, we don't know if he had generational trauma before.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord.
Also, it's always great to clone a grave robber, but I digress.
Yeah, I've never agreed. I did not actually think he was going to make Dofi or Moria. Like, I saw the rest of them.
Yeah.
Like, even Crocodile, because at some point they were helpful to the Straw Hats. So you just kind of see that switch in humanity and potential within them.
Right.
But,
and at least with Crocodile, you know that there is just a massive amount of marketing backing him. So they got to bring Croco back in some capacity.
But
the other two are just like too outlier. You know what I mean?
Yeah, right.
Just too volatile.
I wonder did they chop a child's hand off?
To give him the hook?
I hope not. Oh.
Yeah, they didn't chop a child's hand off. That would be way too hard. They did it when he was an infant.
Oh! right in the incubator.
Hand incision.
They took it off of the tank, brother.
Oh! Goodness gracious. Okay, we're going to get to 1099, everybody. Just hold on.
Probably trying to protect his face and, like, put up his arm.
He's not iconic enough. We wouldn't be able to tell if that was Crocodile if we didn't have the scar.
I'm also happy the hair gel is genetic to slick back Crocodile's hair, because that's needed.
The hair gel and the scar are both part of the lineage factor, didn't you hear?
Oh.
He's born with it.
Maybe he's born with it. Maybe it's lineage.
Hence the hair gel.
Oh. Oh, this is a good show. Oh, it's red hot. All right, so we are a week away from a very monumentous occasion, in which we will have chapter 1100. And it makes me feel like a senior citizen.
Absolutely.
I cannot wait for chapter 1111, baby.
Oh, that's happening. Oh, boy.
It's gonna be a good one.
Absolutely, we're getting ones in chat for that, boys.
Yes, ones in chat. Hope Daz Bones is in that chapter.
Could you imagine?
Yo!
Dude, that might straight up be the cover page.
I hope so. Okay. Okay, we should get into it. Okay.
I hope Zoro's in that chapter, because you remember OPLA where Zoro's like, I gotta be number one.
Oh, don't bring that. Oh my. People already hate me enough for that, Zach. Come on.
Gotta be number one.
So, 1099. I know last week's chapter wasn't finished.
Yeah.
Is this not one of the cleanest chapters that Oda has produced since Wano?
It's gorgeous. Look at the fire. Look at the fire.
This chapter's great.
Yeah, the first page just blew me away. I was just staring at it for a while. You're like, is this One Piece?
I've been wondering, is this One Piece or have we dipped into Berserk? Because it's been reading like Berserk.
It's been reading like Berserk.
Oh.
Oh, no!
Also, well,
especially this King Bakori. He's definitely like Berserk level villain.
Yo!
I think Bakori is like perfect One Piece level villain.
Yeah.
Because One Piece villains are either like One Piece kings in general. You either have like kind, justly good kings like Dalton and Cobra.
Yeah.
And
Riku.
The guy Riku. Like really good and just kings that everyone universally loves. Or you have these ugly, fat, disgusting, despicable, horrible, terrible people who will just destroy the lives of everyone around them because they find it hilarious. There is no in between. There are no gray kings.
Yeah, they're either men of benevolence or just scum of the earth.
Yeah, salt of the earth, baby.
I tell you, he was gray, but we'll get to him later. But yeah, Kuma is. Oh, look at him gritting his teeth. Goodness.
Oh, Kuma's so good.
Oh, I kiss it. Mwah. Delicious.
Love you. Love you, Dad.
Is he wearing his glasses right here? Is that why they got the shine?
I think
he's just that pissed off.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's like the glasses, but they might be alluding to like the fact that he's gonna be a cyborg later.
Yeah, it's artistic decision. Like you see the wrath of the tyrant. Or Oda is doing a what's the superhero manga? Not One Punch Man.
My Hero Academia?
Yes, he's doing the All Might, yeah.
Maybe.
I am here.
I mean, if you cover the top of his if you cover the top of his head, that is a smile.
Yeah. And then
he's so happy now.
But yeah, Kuma gives the castle a good old Ursa shock, and that's a huge paw.
Yeah, he annihilated that entire thing. Oh my goodness gracious.
Yeah, that's about the size of the galaxy impact from Garp.
Yeah.
True?
Like that's huge.
That's pretty big. Good lord, like... I'm just gonna cut to the end real quick as a quick aside.
Yeah, true.
I love how we start this chapter with Sorbet's one-man revolution, where Kuma solved all of his problems with excessive force and violence.
Yeah.
Only to end it with, I'm just a no-good pacifist.
I'm just a silly Billy.
Shut up, Kuma. No, you are not.
I'm just a little scamp.
I just got a little bit. I went just a little
on the wrong side of the bed with the Corey.
I got a little silly.
Like, I completely agree. I completely agree with him going completely off the cuff, right? Just going completely ridiculous and destroying that entire kingdom.
You shouldn't have talked to him before he had his coffee.
Yeah. But why is he just like, I just love keeping the peace as a pacifist man. Shut up. No.
That's why I destroyed that armada. Oh boy.
I think he knows he's being cheeky there. He's just like, I have the power to destroy a whole armada, but I really don't want to have to do that.
That's fair.
Yeah, that's true.
But it's funny. I love it.
Oh, and
it's just kind of hilarious that that's how Pacifista came to be.
Which, I mean, you were kind of right on that, Zach. You mentioned that like a week ago.
Yeah, because it's like simultaneously, like, I am a pacifista. But also, the government's going to twist that because they're pacifiers.
Right. And also, here is Foxy. Go on, Ghost, my bad.
No, I was just about to cough.
Cool. But yes, here is Vice Admiral Foxy talking to Saturn. That is a joke from the Discord.
Oh, Foxy.
I didn't even recognize... That's hilarious!
Yo! Oh, shout out to Minnie. Good joke, Minnie.
He's got the hair and everything. That looks just like Foxy from behind.
My liege.
I never would have noticed because I don't think about Long Ring Long Land all that often.
And here is Saturn, our man of the hour, looking evil as usual.
Yeah, doing what he does best. Leering.
You wonder if he sleeps in his bedroom as a big spider and there's just a big web.
Oh, that'd be cool.
Just on the wall or like in the corner at a 45 degree angle.
Yeah.
And then Marcus Morris has to call him in for a meeting, so he brings the broom to his room and says, "Get down from there, Saturn. We have the meat."
I don't want to get up. Five more minutes. Panel.
He tries to sleep at a 45 degree angle. But he doesn't do it as a spider. He just has that like innate need to.
Yeah.
And it's something that him and Brooke are going to bond over.
I like that. Very cool.
So I would love if Brooke actually ended up being the one doing like fatal damage.
I mean, he's not going to do fatal damage to Saturn, but they're basically both yokai.
Yeah, because he's a giant skeleton yokai. That's true. I mean, he's called that by Black Maria back in the day.
Yeah. And at the end of the day, I would just like Brooke to do anything.
Yeah. More Brooke is always helpful.
Well, like, Brooke could do, like, a final sealing sort of thing. Like, Kuma could come in, do all the damage that needs to be done, and then Brooke comes in doing, like, the gimmick that needs to happen, like a callback to Thriller Bark when he takes out that massive spider monkey.
Oh, yeah, I get you. Yeah, thank you, because you see the parallels. Because I mentioned that in a video. Like, he looks like, what's his name? Taranza, that's his name. Taranza from Thriller Bark. I had a theory about Saturn is going to give birth sometime during this fight, and he'll have little spider minions. Kind of like Taranza had spider mice.
And it's going to be the same way that we have to defeat them. It's going to be, we have to throw salt into their mouth, except this time it's going to activate his gout.
Yeah! Oh, that's good.
We're going to give him high blood pressure.
Kizaru, my medication. You can be anywhere in the world.
But I just got knocked out by Nika. We didn't think this through.
The sun god strikes again.
I'll get you next time, Gadget. Next time.
Quick, Kizaru, to the ship. Oh, my lumbago. I'll get you next time, buddy. You're a little bear, too. And the day was saved thanks to high blood pressure.
Oh, Lord.
Oh, what a good episode this is.
So, it's Captain Planet when you got salt.
Oh, my God.
Amazing. So,
yeah.
Bonnie gets her devil fruit off screen.
Yeah, kind of like Luffy, but not really.
Luffy, we see how and why he got it.
Yeah.
There's just a devil fruit hanging out in Sorbet. How did this happen?
I think that, like, either some fruits have, like, a timer, not necessarily a timer, but, like, a suspension in which they don't necessarily respawn, and there has to be enough intention for it to be respawned.
Hmm.
Yeah. Or reincarnated. So, since Bonnie's, like, whole thing is wanting to reach 10 so that she can be healed, go out and travel the world with her father, like, that's been her only focus.
Like, the fruit kind of chose her.
Right, like,
fruits are based off of dreams in that way.
Yeah.
So, either the fruit hadn't remanifested because no one really cared enough to remanifest the fruit, or the previous user died through misuse, and then in that transition, through her will, it like shot across the world and went to her because she had the highest need for it.
Possible. What you're saying,
what
Zach?
If she made the fruit?
I mean, that's possible because it, like, well, like, well,
we
no,
don't exactly know where or how they come from.
Well, no, because it's recorded because they put out the Delphi encyclopedia on it.
Oh, okay.
So it did exist before her actually having it, but like what Ghost said, yeah, her intent is so strong to be at a certain age that it just sort of presented itself to her. Which is very possible because we don't know how essence invades fruits for them to spawn in the world. So, yeah, I vibe with it.
And then with Mask Deuce and Ace, you can see like with communal eating, whoever eats first gets that ability. So it could have just been a fruit that was brought to the church, and all the poor people were, you know, eating together, and she just happened to eat that fruit first and shared it with someone else. But like, she obviously got the power.
Yeah.
And to that
she would share food.
Like, this might be the first time, because I don't think Bonnie ever says she ate a fruit.
No, she wasn't even aware. She looked in the mirror and said, what?
Yeah. She didn't even say, oh, I ate this dumb fruit and it looked terrible and it tasted bad. Like,
yeah.
Is this the first time that's ever happened with a devil fruit?
I think so. Well, then it makes sense because she's a glutton. So she's just stuffing things in. Oh, that came out bad. Cut that. But yeah, now I'm keeping it in because it's funny. yeah, but like the first time we see her depicted as a child, she's got this big fruit bowl in front of her. Like this was an SBS or something.
Yeah.
And she's tiny Bonnie and she has a big fruit bowl in front of her. So like what Ghost said, this could be like those were offerings to the church, and she's just like, oh, yummy. And just ate all the fruit, and then one of them happened to be a devil fruit.
Ate all the fruit that belongs to my boy JC? Unacceptable.
Terrible.
She's off the crew.
He would have just doubled it and gave it to the next person.
You might be on more times than this, Ghost. This is amazing. But, appearance of the devil fruit encyclopedia, which is very much how, like, Luffy got his fruit, except I saw that Lucky Roo pulled out the full book, but no, it's just a picture that he drew of the gum gum fruit.
Oh.
So.
Yeah, it was just like, just a picture that they had.
Assuming anyone on Shanks' crew can read. Hilarious.
True.
My man has a bunch of goobers on his crew.
Yasop can't read. I refuse. Now, Ben Beckman is like the only man who can read because he's the smartest man in the East Blue.
Could you imagine if he's the smartest man in the East Blue, but he didn't learn how to read?
W. Oda.
Or it's the fact that he can read. That's why he's the smartest.
Yeah! The top three in the East Blue are...
Yeah, it's a 5% literacy rate.
Shanks turns to Ben Beckman. Where are all these squiggly things under my picture, Ben Beckman?
Writing.
Oh, Lord. What is... Weef or dopamine, that's dead or alive, sir. Ah.
And it says how you're big being is served. This number? In the millions, sir. I can't count that high.
And he uses his hands.
One, two, three. That's a lot!
So it's more than five pieces of food. Incredible.
What do they do with the rest? I live a very modest lifestyle. Whatever will I do with this other 5 million?
And that also ties back to like the fact that he might be a figurelet. Well, he is a figurelet. But does a peasant no need for money. Of that money?
I have no concept of money. I just go and take.
They're starving. We'll give them food. You know what? We'll give them good food. Let them eat cake.
Delicious.
Now I'm thinking maybe when Ben Beckman did the hand gesture, it was at a time where Shanks didn't have two hands, so he thought he was mocking him.
He's just jealous he can't do gang signs anymore.
Oh, no! But, okay, we enter this very funny gag of Bonnie trying to turn into an old woman, and now
that's very good. That's a really good panel right here.
It's so fun. And now we know where Bonnie got the idea for the hat, which is a Luffy-ism, I guess. She is the mother of King Bulldog, the previous king of the Sorbet Kingdom. And her name is Connie, which draws back to when Bonnie turned into her during the Levelly. So it must be that King Bulldog, despite probably being old as dirt, is still active, which I guess makes sense because people can get old in One Piece.
Yeah. I mean, 140? Is it 114 or 140 that Kureha is?
She's in like 140s.
Yeah, yeah. Bikori is spreading lies because he's jealous of Kuma and his giant chin.
So how are we feeling about this whole thing about Kuma? Where he was like this warlord, he was this pirate, he was said to be like an evil guy, and then it just turns out that he's just a big softy and he's just good in every conceivable way. How do we feel about that?
Well, you know my answer, Zach, but I'll let Ghost say it first.
I love Kuma. He's my boy. Kuma. I need to see him smile again. We posted it in the chat, that picture of him smiling.
Oh, yeah.
It just warms my heart every time.
The voice chat. Voice general. What are your thoughts, Zach? I'll let you go.
I think I like the idea of morally gray Kuma more than I like the idea that he is just the goodest and bestest boy.
That's fair.
But
we kind of see that through his comments at the end where he is kind of gray, where he's just like, you know, I'm capable of much destruction, but I want to be a pacifist. So he like does what's necessary. Because when Ginny was captured, he was one man revolutioning just all over the world.
Yeah, but he kind of wasn't, because my boy Dragon didn't give him any backup to go and get her back.
Well, no, I've said in a couple of my videos, if I got captured, leave me. Let me die. Like, I'm it's not worth it if you look at Marineford and how much was lost there. Just to get one person back, you basically lost like a whole bunch of ships, your Yonko commander, and your goal wasn't even fulfilled.
Yeah.
Because that has been the biggest W that we have cited for the Marines in the story so far.
Yep.
My thoughts on this is that I like where this is going. To me, this makes Jinbei look even worse, but that's been a running gag on the podcast.
Oh, no.
What, the first son of the sea?
Because... I love that he knows this intimate knowledge about Sulong. Like, he even knows it's a rumor, it's a possibility, but he believes everything he reads in the paper about Kuma, even though there have been lies spread about him, but that's fine.
I think it's, it goes to show just how deep the misinformation can run, that, like, you're literally within the same organization of the warlords as this person, and you still don't know what's going on with them.
Yeah, I mean, people say Eam is the most powerful person in the world. It's Morgan's.
Yeah.
Morgan's controls information. That's the end game right there, man.
The king behind
Eam is just like short for I'm Morgan's.
I'm Morgan's.
Yo!
I'm Morgan's. It's like Hodor. Eam.
The king behind the scenes, indeed.
I'm Morgan's Eam.
I am very interested for when they finally animate Eam. Because I'm very interested.
Like, voice actor they get.
Exactly.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's going to tell us the gender, too. That's true. Right.
Mm-hmm. Unless they try to keep it real ambiguous. But I have a feeling that if Eam is a guy, they are going to give him the deepest, most imposing voice possible.
True. Huh. That's soon, too, because we're into Egghead soon, right?
We're about to get into Egghead, so right. I'm either guessing that it's going to be a girl voice or, like, Suniska.
Right.
Yeah, something deep and droning.
Yeah.
I'm aiming for a Japanese female Darth Vader. Let's go.
They give him Pika's voice actor, so it's real ambiguous.
Yo!
The first thing you hear is
my man.
We're bringing it back, baby.
Yeah, could you imagine if, like, the first thing we hear from Eam is how they laugh?
Oh lordy. Here's my favorite panel. Kuma's holding up Connie and not Bonnie.
Yeah.
I love this because he's actually mistaken his old daughter for this old woman.
Just in the mass of confusion, just his fatherly instincts finally fall through.
That's a very good gag.
It's so good.
How does Kuma already have more gags than Jinbei?
Oh, this is the pain.
The literal robot man has more gags than Jinbei.
The stoic pacifist, sometimes but not really, has more gags. Okay. Yeah.
It's to subvert our expectations.
I hope so. But I won't get into this fish-shaped hole that I often drag us down into.
That I often try to drag you in myself.
Oh, no! I'm resisting. We have company. I'll be a good boy. But yes.
Like, that is so lackadaisical for how they say this. Like, the verbiage here. Like,
wait, where are you
of
at?
Course Kuma sunk the entire armada.
Because he's base.
Yeah.
He's so base.
He's just that guy.
That is so matter of fact. Yeah, of course. Kuma sunk the entire armada.
Honest. Kuma showed up, stood his ground, and then they were gone. Yes, they were.
Also, I pointed this out in my video. His little dinghy looks like the buggy boat that I think Sanji and Luffy were on back in, I think, was it Arlong Park? But it looks just like this. It's green and yellow and has a... Hold on. Yeah, because it's got the little thing in the front, yeah.
Kuma gave it to Buggy.
Yes, he did. That's my headcanon. I'm sticking to it.
He just threw it to East Blue and Buggy found it.
I'm like, oh, look at this, boys. Perfectly good chip on the shore.
It's like, I don't need this anymore.
Bakuri gets decimated, and it's very funny. And we don't see his bounty, which, okay.
I mean, have we ever found out what Kuma's bounty was when it was frozen?
Like, it's been said it's been 296 million.
Yeah. I assume all the warlords have, like, a bounty at the time that they got frozen when they became warlords.
Blackbeard was the only one.
Yeah, he had his was zero.
He had no bounty. Yeah,
right.
Literally zero. Which that's interesting in itself. Zero.
Yeah. So for his bounty on the wiki, it says at least 296. So it's like that's still vague.
Yeah.
Which is weird.
Yeah, it's rude.
Try to look at all these different places. Is that Thriller Bark?
That's,
I recognize Thriller Bark.
Not as Gloomy Island.
Oh, Gloomy Kingdom, right.
And we have my favorite boys, Abdul and Jeet, baby!
Oh, Jeet, that's his name.
Yes.
I recognized Abdul immediately.
Future followers of Nika. Mm-hmm. And Kuma just blows them up. Fantastic. Look how Lazarus
is. This is this the Baljimore Kingdom?
Yes, it is. That's Vegapunk's old kingdom.
Yeah.
Also the kingdom of Dr. Oh, what's his name? It starts with T. Just
T-Bone, baby.
No. Tsukimi? Dr. Tsukimi.
He Tsukimi.
He built the Spaceys, the little guys that love NL.
Yeah.
The Automata?
The Automata, yes, there we go. Got me thinking about video games, because they're called Spaceys in, like, that video game for the Wii I told you about earlier.
Yeah.
But yeah, they're Automata, you're absolutely correct. Yeah, he goes to Wavaria, he goes to the bridge, Tequila Wolf. Don't know.
I wonder what he thought he would find there, or if he was just sailing by and said, man, this place sucks.
Right?
Well, maybe he knew that the Revs were there. I don't know. Like, maybe he was hoping to run into Dragon there or something.
Yeah. Maybe he's saving our comrades who are imprisoned here. Oh, well, that was a lost cause anyway.
Whoops.
Right.
He goes with it.
He also went to the Bowen Islands.
Yeah, with my boy Heracles. Yes, sir.
Oh, my God. That is Heracles.
Oh,
he's here. I didn't even notice. My son!
The boy is here.
Oh, God, it's been so long.
Look at this base. These two chads conversing. So good.
Oh, I love Heracles so much.
Got my boy Usopp into fighting shape. Taught him about plants. Base character. W character. Go on.
You know what's, like, even further evidence that, like, there's just as many parallels between Kuma and Usopp as there is between Kuma and Franky? Mm. Is when he goes to the Bowen Islands and he gets all fat, he's got like the physique of a buccaneer.
True! Yeah.
He's big and he's got like the little legs.
Oh man, I really wish that Kuma was fat in this shot though.
Chunky boy.
Kuma gets fat and talks to Heracles and he just pushes all the weight out.
Oh, that's base. But I would probably not survive on the Bourne Archipelago because that food looks delicious. Oh my god. Mm-hmm. Goodness.
Oh yeah, I would die for whatever flower is about to eat me.
Heracles would save me and I would become his student.
Also, need to point out, he actually meets Haradas. If you don't know, Haradas is a Birkin, the same race as NL, but he does not have wings. So that means he might have been the deity of Burka. That was chased out by NL because he's a coward. Anyway, let's go on.
Yeah, do all the deities of Burka have to tear off their wings, or is that just something NL did?
Like, Ganfall did it too. He didn't have any wings because he was the deity of Skypiea.
Huh.
And I think NL's a poser. That's why he tore off his wings.
That's fair.
I don't know where he got the Raijin drum idea from. Perhaps a traveler showed him a cool picture and he thought it was rad.
Maybe he just thought it looked really cool and
I think so.
Maybe Oda just thought it looked really cool and did it.
Yeah.
Perhaps Oda loves him some Eminem and decided, what if I made Eminem, but he was a Raijin? Let's put that in my manga.
Reminem.
Yo! and now we have the... I was going to make a bad joke. The man scarred by flames is ship. Who is all black? Look at this dragon ship.
The man scarred by flame is just dragon.
Also,
no discernible reason.
Also, I just want to point this out. So the symbol of the Revolutionary Army is a dragon. You're on a ship, but the figurehead's a dragon. Are you not afraid of being found out at all? That's just riding around.
If you if you're the type of person that's going to get scared of seeing that, you're not going to last very long after seeing it.
True.
Like, you're going to be taken out pretty quick. Like, if you're seeing that and not the target audience, you're not long for this world.
Fair.
Yeah, because Dragon is exceptionally cautious.
Yep.
To the point where, well, we lost a few guys. They're in prison. Take it easy, Eva and Inazuma. I'm sure you'll come out in about 20 years when my son comes to visit.
I find it so funny that he's like, oh, Inazuma and Ivankov are in prison. No biggie. A few years later, he is on the phone. Ivankov, help. The organization has been found out. I need to crash your pad. Please. Please. It's ridiculous. But
I cannot believe. I cannot believe that he can't even... He can't even change a member of his staff without getting Kuma's express permission first.
That's just reverence, bro.
I thought that was nice.
I don't know, man.
That's just a nice gesture. He was definitely sending people out. Like, he wasn't just saying, like, okay, I guess it's just undefended now.
I guess.
Though
it was more of like a figurative thing. It's like the second in command was the acting leader.
I like how I'm going.
This is like a revolution. He's got to have someone in that position, right?
Well, I guess he's not like the Marines, which is weird. But
and if this guy is going to be willing to, you know, look at this cold and calculated wise to the point where you're not going to go out and try to get your people back from having despicable acts done to them in the cause that you're trying to fight. If that's the cold and calculated kind of guy that you are, shouldn't you also be willing to, I don't know, like, shouldn't you be willing to, like, change the role, the position? I don't know. This character's just all over for me.
Well, I mean, I think we've kind of lost a bit of his character to the, kind of the romance of the narrative, because it is a nice gesture that he waited. Doesn't make any logical sense. Not really.
And we're seeing it through Kuma's lens and his emotions, too.
Yeah. Because Because the idea, I guess, is like, this is Bonnie reliving the memories that she saw through the memory bubble in Vegapunk's lab. So it makes sense. So, like, this is like what Ghost said. It's kind of through his eyes, because we're literally seeing Bonnie reflect on the memories that she saw. Is it still weird a little bit? Also, I want to point out, what happened to Bello Betty? Because she's all conservative and kind of nice here. We see her in the story. She's completely different. So that's
interesting. Word has changed her.
Yep. And we see Morley as well. Right when Ivankov and Inazuma are getting captured. But I'm sure that's not connected at all. Nope. Not at all.
It was a plan to keep them there.
I mean, having eyes on the inside of Impel Down is pretty good.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Especially because they were looking
obviously able to like get information in and out. Like, they knew what was going on.
So Impel Down is a great place to recruit strong people for your cause against the government.
I mean, yeah, Blackbeard chose us that. Though Blackbeard did in a way cooler way, I must say.
Blackbeard did?
Yeah, Blackbeard in a way cooler way.
Fight for my affection.
Also interesting, what is the kind of like a pet theory? Morley and what's his name? Sanwan Wolf being related. Though I don't know if there's any. Well, there is some backing, because they both like are related deeply to Impel Down.
Mm-hmm. Well, and like Morley is an Okama as well, and like Sanwan Wolf kind of gives off that little bashful Okama as well.
Yeah, and they're both giants.
I hope they fight each other. It'd be cool.
Oh, that'd be cool.
It won't happen, but
I see the Revolutionary Army fighting like the top tiers.
Yeah, I don't. Well, the Revs are going to have to fight somebody, right? It's probably going to be some big marine force. Maybe the God's Knights is what they're setting up for. Maybe a bunch of vice admirals that we happen to be seeing on Egghead right now. But I would think that they would want to be fighting someone directly affiliated with the government.
Yeah.
Not exactly Blackbeard.
Yep.
Even if they do have beef.
Or
I see them taking down like world government people for sure.
Yeah.
Like that's their goal. Like they're going to be taking out the God's Knights, whether like they're actually as strong as the Gorosei is yet to be seen, or like what power level they are. But
fair.
I'm really excited to see everything unfold with the world government side.
I'm very excited to see what the plan is for the God's Knights.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, Zach, a little spite needs to be expressed. Remember when you, I, and a mutual acquaintance were talking about Kuma's hands?
Mm-hmm.
Look how he's holding the mug here.
Without his palms?
Yeah, without his palms. He's holding it with one finger, and the rest of it's collapsed over his hand. Okay. I'm not saying nothing. Why would he be depicted that way? Why not grasp with your full hand, like Dragon's doing?
Like grasp it!
But okay. There's so I would need that to be explained. Come on now. That's
but in the page right before, he's also firmly grasping his forehead with his full hand.
Zach, don't
it
do
goes
it.
Everywhere. It goes everywhere, dude.
Oh my god. Ah. Right when I thought I had it, I got defeated.
I feel like this is kind of like a Kuro situation, though, where he's tried to teach himself to not grasp things as to not push them.
Yeah.
And maybe that's just something that he kept as like a little, I guess, like a nervous tick, like a... just like a permanent thing.
The way he's holding the barrel with like his knuckles.
Yeah. Like he's holding the barrels with his knuckles. He's not trying to grasp it because maybe when he first got the power, he would send things out if he grasped things, but now he can control it better. Who knows?
Yeah.
Well, like with that last cover story with him like trying to fish, it was like, where was he sending the fish?
Right. True. Which is very funny. Because he's a bear in the river hunting salmon. Very good. So yeah, him and Dragon are talking. They're broing out. And a lot of people have been taken by this line that Dragon says, "Go where the winds of fate take you, my friend." It's a good line. It can read differently how you take it, but I think it's a good line.
For the official.
Yeah.
So people were just like, "Wind Logia confirmed."
Is this after? I always forget. Is this after? Oh God, what's Robin's hometown again?
O'Hara.
Yeah. Is this after O'Hara?
Yes.
Yes.
Because he's got the tattoo on his face, right? Right.
Yes.
They were just the freedom fighters at that point, and then like later on, like a decade later, they became the Revolutionary Army.
Because Vegapunk is coming across as extremely naive right now, right?
It's strange.
Am I getting that kind of view from him?
It's strange. Because, like, it doesn't seem like he has malicious intent, but he's also not aware that his lab is bugged.
Like, he's the smartest man in the world, and he's also really trusting of other people.
Yeah.
And I would have been able to accept that if this was before O'Hara.
Yeah, because he actually saw the devastation of O'Hara. Yeah, true. And he's already been to Elbath. He met with Saul already. Yeah.
He's coming across right now. Like, he's like, oh, I want to create these big, awesome super soldiers, right? And they're gonna go around the entire world and protect everyone. It's going to be really cool. And Kuma, I want you to represent this new pacifying pacifist movement that I'm giving to the world government. This giant robot soldier. I'm sure that they will use it responsibly.
As they always have in the past when given.
Like, brother.
Destructionary devices.
Oh. It's not looking good.
He is not beating the allegations.
F in the chat. It's not looking good.
F in the chat for Fed.
Yeah. Fed, big Fed.
I think he's just like, in his pursuit of knowledge, he's just too much of a sunny optimist to really grasp the idea of the malicious intent behind people sometimes.
Which is why he sees the good in all of his apprentices.
Yep.
All of them. Even that one. You know the one. The one who's doing the same thing he's doing, but in the worst possible way.
Yeah.
Which yep. I guess is all of them. Man.
Which is all of them. Yeah, I love that all of his apprentices are like the smartest man in the world. And they each have like one field that Vegapunk works at.
And they're all horrible. Horrible, horrible.
And they all suck. Except for two of them, I really like two of them. So I'm willing to forgive all of their terrible, awful war crimes because Zoom is Zoom is Zoom.
You can't do that, Zach. But he is a dinosaur, though.
All is forgiven for dinosaur.
All is forgiven for my boy Queen.
He is in the shape of my favorite chicken nugget, so I don't know.
And you know what? Like, C's a clown, pretty bad guy. But, like, you know, if it was, like, Gangster Gastino that did all that kind of stuff, then maybe I'd be more willing to forgive him.
Oh, exactly, because you'd expect that from Gastino. Like,
yeah, you expect...
That's just where he came from. That's how he was raised.
He comes from a rough neighborhood.
I don't know any better. Slack.
Leave the body. Take the cannoli.
I was just watching the house.
I want a cannoli. So bad right now. Oh.
I've never been a fan, honestly.
Really?
I love sweet stuff, but for some reason, cannoli...
Cannoli just don't do it for you.
Just don't do it for me.
Ah, not well.
I love sweets, though.
Hmm. Ooh, now I'm thinking about... I gotta stay on topic. No.
Pie, though.
We were having such a great time.
I got some pie in the fridge. I can't wait. I'm having that for breakfast tomorrow. Anyway.
Amazing.
This is not food.
I want pie.
Oh.
Let's talk about whole cake for the rest of the podcast.
We did that already. We can't do it again. But then again, it is our show, so I...
We do what we please.
True.
All right, we can
talk about it
Vegapunk.
Every week.
But Vegapunk for real, though.
But Vegapunk for real.
Speaking of man who can make pie for breakfast every day, Vegapunk.
I like that Bonnie comes out of a barrel like our boy Luffy on her first grand adventure. Very good. I think you mentioned that ghost in your video. W mentioned. I like that. I didn't even notice that. And he has his full palm on the barrel, so I don't know anymore. But yeah, little baby comes out of the barrel. Vegapunk likes her cheeky attitude. Bonnie's like, whoa, holy cow, your head's huge and it's creepy. I don't like you, Gramps.
He's like, oh, I can't say the darndest things. I'm going to clone this one
of that
so
barrel
many
like
times.
Burris.
Wait, what?
I said, coming out of that barrel like Hannibal Burris at a roast, like, I don't like you. You smell funny. You're weird. I don't like the way you look. You scare me.
Gadzooks, people coming out. Yeah, that is kind of rude. Like, people come all shape and size. Sir, your head is filling the room. Get out of here.
Yeah, the call is coming from inside the head.
I see why he got that thing cut down, though. Good lord. He can't leave his house. But yeah, we got baby Bonnie playing with Centomaru. Before we started, Ghost, he looks younger here. It's hard to tell, though.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. We're trying to beat the time allegations on this, but I don't know. Because, like, Egghead is still a Winter Island, as we see. Punk Records hasn't been established. There are no satellites. So it's very interesting where the time is going. But
more and more, it feels like the Bonnie clone allegations, though, for the satellites.
You know, since you brought it up, here's the disgusting part. You remember Ginny?
What about her?
You know how she has freckles, right?
Yeah. Huh?
What's another character that we know of that has freckles and who is very gluttonous?
Oh, man, it might just be York if I had to guess.
Oh, Lord. Vegapunk, no! And he's spending all this time studying Bonnie's DNA. Oh, this is the bad timeline. I hope it's not. I hope it's not.
All he wanted was peace.
The stem cells are just...
Gone, Ghost?
Are the stem cells that he's going to be using from Ginny?
Oh, I'm going to give her some stem cells, but I'm also going to take a few.
We're just going to do a complete replacement.
I'm just saying, while I can give her this extremely potent, life-saving surgery, stem cells don't come cheap. I'll just have to make about 20, 30, 50 clones. And then just take away the Ghibli bits while they're still making. And if I could just get some free DNA, I mean, that would be great to help me. I mean, you know, research costs and all that.
And eating is kind of a hassle, which automatically makes me a villain. So I'm just going to designate that to someone that will be like me, but not me. But look like your bride, but it's not your bride. But it also looks like your daughter, but it's not your daughter, though. Love you, Kuma. Bye.
Take it easy, buddy.
Here's your kid.
Memories and soul. All right, cool.
I hate this.
I don't think it's that sinister.
I can definitely see the
whole like full circle of like the clones breaking down being like portions of Ginny or Bonnie in some way, because as she's introduced, her epithet is the glutton. And there's six other satellites, her possibly being that seventh.
Yeah.
As like the seventh deadly sin, gluttony, wrath, all that stuff.
Very possible.
And then there's like the cloning, or like the process of the stem cells would be like cloning them or making them a cyborg. So there's that extra extension of that concept in this chapter as well. So it's very possible that she could be young, but she could also be a cyborg or a satellite.
We will have to see.
I would think if she was a satellite, Vegapunk would have probably programmed something in her that caused her to not attack him on sight.
I think that there might, if like she is indeed a satellite, you need knowledge of like your existence to have like your authority chip inside you active, and she might actually have the highest authority chip even over the Gorosei.
It's possible.
So now that she's had like these memories instilled back into her, she might understand like, hey, I can have a way to fight back against this person. And that was like Vegapunk's failsafe. Is like, okay, this is the one piece of information I can hide from anyone and everyone.
Unless we find out that Bonnie is actually Saturn's daughter, and she is effectively a Gorosei.
Don't put that evil in here. Though my theory is not much better, so let it ride. I'm sorry.
It's either a Gorosei or some other high level celestial dragon, so it's like
it doesn't even have to be high level is the whole thing about it. Like, I hope we never find out which one it is. I hope we never put a name on that,
because it's gonna get worse if we do.
Also, is this the first time that we see Vegapunk's laugh?
Oh wait, when did he laugh?
I think we see it when he's introduced once,
maybe, because I really like his laugh. I just wanted to mention that. Pit 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 pit.
Yeah, just bite.
Because he's got his tongue out.
On his tongue.
Yeah. It sounds like he's spitting.
Ew.
Spitting facts.
Yeah.
Spitting facts and logic. Well, maybe not logic, but definitely facts.
But to kind of jump back to the Saturn thing with Bonnie, unfortunately. I know, Polybeat. I'll jump off it in a second.
No, it's fine. No, it's not. Go nuts, but brother.
In the last chapter, when she's given the middle finger to those kids, Yeah. That's actually like a representation of Saturn too. Like the middle finger is Saturn's finger. And then the sapphire scale is like, you know, sapphire is Saturn's
whole
thing. So it was really funny that she was giving the middle finger to someone in that last chapter.
Really? And Saturn has allegories sometimes with Satan, so it makes sense that she was warded off or pretend warded off by a crucifix. Mm-hmm. So,
it's all coming together, boys.
I hate it.
I mean, Oda wants us to hate it.
Yeah, and then he's got big bull horns, like a devil. Ah, jeez. Ah, it's
yep.
Ah, it's all there. All right, and he comes in by a giant sigil in the floor. Ah, all right. But I like that. Sentamaro and Bonnie are becoming friends, which makes him saving her after she's fried by the Labo phase even the more heartwarming.
Yeah. I love all the interactions within, like, the Egghead Island.
Oh my god. Area. Just in general, every interaction with Bonnie is kind of blessed.
It is. Yep.
Cause they got Bonnie and Sentamaro. They're talking about young Sabo and Koala with Kuma.
Also, my alarm went off for a koala. I'm like, yes, 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 yes.
She's still in the story, boys.
I love Koala. Such a good character.
She's great. Yeah, I like Bonnie with Zoro. That was good. Bonnie and Sanji's funny, which I want that to become a usual thing because I want
Sanji cannot escape the allegations anymore.
No, don't do this to my lad. Don't do it.
No, he'll
it's
be
a representation for the entire community.
Oh my goodness.
The best thing is, believed. Like, once he knows it's a child, he'll understand, though.
Yeah.
If it, I
he'll understand.
Oh boy. This needs to get ironed out, Oda, please.
Sanji is going to be devastated.
But yeah, Sanji and Bonnie, Luffy and Bonnie is always blessed.
Mm-hmm. They just both love food.
I think Sanji would love to have like a little sister.
Yeah,
I always felt like he was more of like an older sister kind of guy.
Yeah.
Just because of his relationship with Reiju.
Yeah.
But I think being able to like extend that relationship to another that he never had. Like
that's fair.
Yeah. Good takes. Good takes all. Very good takes.
Either way, I'm still firmly in the Bonnie will not join the Straw Hats.
Fair.
I would like
this,
it.
This is really making me feel like she's going to join the Revolutionaries.
Oh, I hope not. Oh,
because they mentioned Bonnie kind of being the same, roughly around the same age. Like, you know, still kids and all that is like Sabo and Koala.
Yeah.
So they might be a trio in the Revs.
Yeah.
A trio of characters we actually care about in the Revolutionary Army.
Yeah. But based on what happened to Guinea, I'm not confident about her joining the Revs. I hate that. Ah, it makes sense. I'm not going to deny you. It makes sense. It's so sour. Oh, it's sour.
It's just that we've spent so much time with the rest of Dragon's family and seeing how they would have reacted to the exact same thing and succeeding every time.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Well,
I mean, we've seen both from Garp. We've seen him go in action and then into action.
Yeah.
So I think we might have just seen Dragon's in action, and then we're about to see his action, which is going
to
be huge.
Man, I sure hope that we get to see Dragon do anything.
I mean, it took this long for Emu to do anything.
Emu wasn't in the story in
Logtown, yeah.
In Logtown.
It's
people have argued that Emu has been there since chapter one because of that whirlpool.
Emu wasn't name dropped and shown in chapter one.
No, you know what I mean, though. Like,
yeah.
But
as far as like shadow leaders go, you have people out there doing the work, like, you know, Sabo, he's doing the work. Saturn, they're doing the work. they're the chief of staff sort of thing.
I wonder, is okay, so Vegapunk obviously is younger than Saturn, because we see Saturn kind of is unaging, or at least that's been the suggestion.
Yeah.
I wonder, is he like a phenomenon that has burst on the scene and Saturn just seized him as an opportunity after like this Metzling Mads? Or was there someone before Vegapunk who was like Saturn's lackey? Cause
like as a science man?
Yeah, like a science man. Like, is, cause I can't believe Vegapunk is the first person with a brain fruit.
Probably not.
Oh, definitely not.
Huh, so that's just a wonder. Or like,
but you have to wonder with like the lifespan of humans being anywhere between like 100 and 140 in the One Piece world. How many times is the fruit reincarnated? And how easy is it to find that user each time?
And, I mean, just wait for them to get a big old head.
And then, yeah, the big head thing is interesting because you can actually be debilitated by this ability.
Mm-hmm. But if you're in a place with like very little information, like the East Blue, like what are you going to remember?
True. If you're not one to study either, then there's no need for your head to get big. That's interesting because that could be like a useless ability.
Yeah.
Wow. I never thought of it like that. Yeah.
I mean, a lot of the Devil Fruits could just be useless abilities if they don't have the right user.
True, like Law's fruit. The previous user was said like to be kind of bad because he wasn't a doctor.
Because like, it gives Luffy's you like fruit. Endless capacity, but does it give you endless understanding?
True. That's another thing.
I mean, just look at Orochi. Great fruit, terrible user.
Actually garbage.
Actually piss.
Vegapunk is telling Kuma about her Super Sentai dreams of having totally benevolent robots at his beck and call.
Like, how on earth could he believe this?
Well, you know what, Zach? Some people are book smart and some people are street smart. Looking at that head, he ain't street smart.
He's just so naive. The smartest man in the world.
He's a sunny optimist. Like everyone thinks he's like so cheeky and like so evil this chapter. Yeah. I don't see it. He's just dumb.
Like I throw out like the evil Vegapunk stuff kind of as a joke.
But people who are actually like taking it seriously, like, yeah, oh man. Like,
Vegapunk does accidentally villainous things.
Exactly.
I've never seen him really do anything out of pure malice.
So I wonder, does that exist in him? Because how do we have York? Then again, I think I know how we got to that point.
We've seen Lilith, who is his representation of his evil.
And she's not evil.
She's like compassionate and kind.
Just a little money hungry. Right. So she's just Nami. She's
like chaotic neutral.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you're
like, Vegapunk probably ain't totally evil.
And then York.
But I like to think about that.
Yeah. And then York might just be how Vegapunk treats York instead of York being an aspect of Vegapunk's evil. Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah. York might be nurture rather than nature.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like Kuma in glasses. I just want to point that out. It's great.
Kuma looks great.
He looks so learned.
But
Kuma can't read. It makes the Bible so funny.
I don't think he can.
He's just like, I know there's information in here somewhere.
But he's a good father because he taught his child how to read. W dad, W.
Although I feel like Kuma probably has to be able to read because all the pacifistas can read.
Can they, Zach?
Yeah, we've at least in the anime, we've seen like the inside of their visor.
That's facial,
like giving them information and facial recognition and bounties and names and all that nonsense.
That's fair.
Although, could you imagine?
Yeah,
Vegapunk taught all the pacifistas to read, but not Kuma.
That's a joke. Oh, that's funny. And then we see Saturn listening in on the conversation, oh boy,
he's just always there.
God. He is always there. I wonder, like, who was this? Was it Lucas who brought this up? Or maybe it was Tachi. That maybe each Or maybe it was you, Ghost. I don't know. Maybe each of the Gorosei, or at least five of them, have a warlord that they kind of loom over or watch from the shadows.
Maybe.
Because I can see Dofi being that way. Someone's just watching him and says, if he ever tries to get back into Mary Joyce, deny him. He's too crazy. Deny him. Or like... Moria doesn't seem like someone to be watched, but maybe he is. I'm not sure.
I mean, I'd say that. For
like certain people, they were like Mihawk. They probably just let do whatever because they're like, yeah, whatever.
We all know that Saturn's here on Egghead to deal with the threat of Jinbei. So
why? Ah! And I fall for the bait each time. I'm too predictable.
The Sapphire Scale. Jinbei.
He calls the Sapphire.
He was just a human.
He calls it. He calls the Sapphire Scale disease.
He is just a regular man with Sapphire Scale. He just survived, so he looks like a bluefish.
That would explain why he doesn't look like a whale shark. At all. That bothers me so much. That legit bothers me. He looks like an oni. He doesn't even look like a whale shark. But we have reached the end of the chapter, boys. Any thoughts?
I can't wait for Bonnie to use her powers on Saturn and for them to not work.
Oh. Hmm.
Because she's going to be like young time and get rid of 100 years of them, and it's not going to change at all.
She's
going to go old time. It'll be the same thing.
How do you guys think the Gorosei are potentially extending their health? Like
100%, it's life surgery.
Yeah. The final outcome of the Opi Opi no Mi, because like that's a Chekhov's gun that's got to go off somewhere.
And if it's on anyone, it's on Eam. If it's on anyone, if it's on one person, it's Eam. If it's on multiple people, it's all of the Gorosei.
I think that like. There could be a secondary way to extend your life, and that's like if you've ever seen the Dark Crystal.
Ooh.
Gexies. And how they drink the life essence of the Gelflings and like basically extends their life and increases their power. So they just hook them up to these machines and it drains their life force out of them into these like drinkable cups.
There you go.
Though, like to that point. Like how, because it makes sense in a way, like, okay, if they're keeping Bonnie around, perhaps she's pushing life force out of people, turning that life force into candies, and then the Gorosei eat those candies. Because now the life force is going into somebody else, so it extends the life of that person. Whereas,
is it even possible to destroy the years that Bonnie gets out of people? And what happens if you do?
Right. And then, like, with Kuma, since we've seen the mechanics of how that works, if the essence that has been, well, the feeling that has been turned into matter has to go somewhere. So maybe if the crystals don't go anywhere, if there's no life for them to go into, they just return to their source.
They do that and then they just kill the guy?
Exactly.
And then it can't return.
They kill the guy and then you just got life candies, so you eat them. Pop them like popcorn.
Or they like eat as much of the candies as they extract out of the person, then they just like toss that person out as a slave for like the 2 weeks that they're gonna survive.
Also true.
Like your stairs now. It's
like, basically, which is another allegory to Big Bomb, which is very interesting. yet another one.
Yeah, like Soul is another way you could extend your life.
True.
Like, there's so many different ways that you could extend one life with Devil Fruit shenanigans.
Another way is that you can be a horrendous skeletal abomination.
Yeah.
Cursed to wander the earth.
I still think it's eternal surgery.
Yeah, it's the best possible.
A third option is, like, if you know how reindeer have a certain lifespan. Chopper ate a human fruit that extends his life to the potential of a human's.
Yeah.
If you're eating something like a yokai's fruit that is like set to live millennia or like thousands of years,
mm-hmm.
you're going to have that lifespan. So they could just have these fruits that are like intended to have these long lifespans. So it's like you're essentially immortal unless you're beheaded. You know what I mean?
Yeah, unless you are killed.
Right. Like you can be murdered, but you can't die from natural causes and you won't age after a certain point.
That would make sense as to why Luffy can just survive all these life threatening things like even cause hormone injections or the constant use of Gear Second in the pre time skip.
Is this how we're going to explain the whole lifespan thing with Luffy? Is that it didn't matter at all?
Yeah, we're going down swinging, baby. Oh, this had terrible repercussions. Time to make a short about it. Time to make a short about it. Oh boy. Well, man.
Good chapter.
I enjoyed it immensely. And that's a very good point, Ghost, that if you become a mythical being, perhaps your lifespan has just been extended. Because this also goes back to terrible, tiny man Orochi, whose Devil Fruit powers worked even when he was in his human form, because he was beheaded.
Mm-hmm.
And he regenerated. So, like, yeah, it's kind of absolute. Which is weird that mythical Zoans are that absolute, but they are kind of like Paramecius. It just
makes you wonder about, like, Marco, for instance. Can he die?
Yeah, right?
Yeah, when he dies, he'll awaken. It's like...
Yeah? It's like, can he die in any other way but drowning?
Right.
And I had a funny thought about this. Technically, Kaido wouldn't be able to drown.
Because he is a fish.
He's a fish.
It would be the same thing as like Jack.
Yeah.
I guess you would just starve.
That sucks. Unless a fish
is to it. He's the drought.
That's a W reference. That's good. Well, let's see. How far along are we? We're pretty far in. So tell the people where they can reach you, Ghost.
I am reachable on TikTok mostly. Ghost Train of Thought is the channel, or you can search up Ghost Train CC. It'll pop up the same. Same with YouTube, Ghost Train of Thoughts. We'll probably start posting a little bit more on there just to get some more traction, because I want to start going live and doing some more stuff over there.
Yeah.
You have been a great guest, sir. Thanks for coming on. Thank you for accepting my invitation.
I appreciate the extension.
Well, Zach, I think they should subscribe to Ghost Train of Thought, but you know who they should subscribe to as well? Reddit Sephiroth.
Oh, he works, perhaps.
Or Reddit Sephiroth.
Yeah, this is fun. I really appreciate it, dude.
Hell yeah. It's been good.
Bar's open, fellas.